Hello everyone. It's now 5 p.m. Sorry, in Malaysia. It's now 9 a.m. in the UK. Okay, so hi everyone. I hope all of you are well and staying safe. Good morning, maybe good afternoon and good evening to all our esteemed speaker, as well as to a member of IWA and also all the participants from all over the world. Welcome to our International Water Association's specialist group of on sustainable coastal and estuary developments webinar sessions. So today we have the title of the webinar, which is on the climate change and coastal development in Kuwait, key challenges and insight. So we have the speakers, which is Dr. Yousef Alosairi. So he's going to present to us on this topic. But before we go further, let me bring to you a few of the housekeeping rules. So basically, today's we are going to have the introduction by our chair of the specialty group, which is Professor Muthu Kumaru Sivakumar from University of North Warrengon, as well as also we're going to listen to the webinar talk by our speaker, which is Dr. Yousef Alosairi from the research scientist, Coastal and Marine Resource Program, Environment and Life Science Research Center from the Kuwait Institute of Science Scientific Research. So after that, we will spare some time for the Q&A, and I will close this webinars by 10 a.m. in UK times. So we also have to share with you on some of the webinar information. The webinar will be recorded and also made available on our demands on the IWA Connect Plus platform and the IWA Network website with a presentation slide and other informations. The speaker is responsible for securing the copyright permission for any works that they will present of which they are not legal completely holders. The opinions, hypothesis, conclusion, or recommendation contained in the presentation and other materials are the sole responsibility of the speaker and do not necessarily reflect the IWA opinions. So you may see the webinar information here that will cover the chat box as well as the Q&A box. But unfortunately, you cannot raise your hand to ask questions. If you have any questions, if anything in general, you can just type on the chat box. If you have any question for the speaker, and please, you can type at the Q&A box here. So next, I will invite our chair of the specialty group, which is Professor Sivakumar. He will share with you about our specialty group, as well as to give the introduction about our webinars. And also he will going to introduce to you about our speakers. Professor Sivakumar, the floor is yours.
So thank you, Professor Teo. Greetings to all participants. I sincerely thank you all for your time and attending our webinar. We are a relatively new specialist group within the International Water Association. We were previously called the International Association for Coastal Reservoir Research for about 7 years, and we have completely merged with IWA as a specialist group. Our main aim is to promote coastal reservoir and tidal basin technologies for water and energy security and urban and agricultural development across world's coastal regions. We also would like to promote sustainable technologies for coastal and estuarine restoration, including waterfront developments. So in this regard, so we have interest in water, energy, as well as in waterfront developments. We have actually conducted two webinars to date. The first one was held late last year in September on nature-based solutions for sustainable coastal and estuarine development. We focused on Netherlands' experience and also from UNESCO. It was delivered by Professor Arthur Meinert from Netherlands and Dr. Elfriede Rama from UNESCO. And the second webinar was on tidal range energy opportunities and challenges. This was mostly focused on the applications in UK. This was delivered by Professor Roger Faulkner from Cardiff University and Kate Gilmartin from British Hydropower Association. So that was in June 2024. These two webinars can be viewed on demand at any time from the IWA webinars website. So this is our third webinar in series. Today we'll delve into, as Professor Teo mentioned, about climate change and coastal development, focusing on Kuwait and the key challenges and insights. It's going to be presented by Dr. Yousef Alosairi. I'm very pleased to introduce him because he's essentially an expert in hydro-environmental numerical modeling. And he's the head of the Coastal Numerical Modeling Unit at the Kuwait Institute of Scientific Research. He obtained his bachelor's, master's, and PhD from the School of Engineering from Cardiff University in the UK. His career has been dedicated to unraveling the hydrodynamic processes of the Gulf, with a special focus on Kuwait marine environment. His research has revealed critical transport and mixing patterns within the Gulf, shedding light on pressing environmental challenges such as hypoxia and fish die-offs. Dr. Alosairi's work has applied multiple models, they are numerical models, to analyze dissolved oxygen dynamics and sediment transport, building a comprehensive view of these complex systems. Recently, his efforts have been focused on developing a hydrodynamic forecasting system to enhance prediction of algal blooms and pollutant dispersion. These are problems happening throughout the world, these type of issues. So over a decade, Dr. Alosairi has been instrumental in establishing and managing an extensive observational network, including the use of autonomous vehicles. So these tools have played a key role in validating models and deepening the understanding of the physical aspects of the marine environment. So in addition to his research, he was recently appointed as a board member at the Kuwait Ports Authority, where he contributes his expertise to strategic decision-making. Now, it is indeed my pleasure to invite Dr. Alosairi to deliver his presentation. Over to you, Dr. Alosairi.
Thank you very much, Dr. Siva. Thanks to everyone. And good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are around the world. It is my great pleasure to be presenting this topic at this event. And thank you for making the time to attend the presentation. And I hope towards the end you find it useful and informative. And before I start, I'd like to thank Kuwait Institute for Scientific Research for providing a lot of fund towards the key findings in this presentation. This also extends to KFAS, Kuwait Foundation for the Advancement of Sciences. Many of the results here presented was funded by KFAS as well. And of course, Deltares and NCSER, we use a lot of their models, including Delf3D, DelfDevM, and Kuwait Institute for Scientific Research is a beta user. And thanks for the Port Authority as well, which I act as a board member, as Siva has mentioned. But before I start, I would like to bring to your attention, I'm not sure why I'm not being able to click into this. Wait. Oh, yeah. Before I start, I would like to present the motivation of this talk. In fact, in Kuwait, as a coastal region, are experiencing rapid development. This includes elsewhere within the Gulf. Yet the climate resilience remain inadequately addressed. This gap is driven by the inherent uncertainties and cost challenges associated with predictive climate models. And the predictable and the unpredictable human responses, which in many cases are very slow to emerging climate risks, the reluctance to the base design on uncertain projections exposes waterfront infrastructure to risks such as sea level rise, extreme weather events and challenging coastal dynamics, which I would show in this presentation. So first, I would start with general physical characteristics of the Gulf, and this will extend to Kuwait waters and how those water bodies communicate together. Then the general circulation of the Gulf, then the key development in Kuwait waterfront developments and how they are affected or related to climate change. And then the environmental challenges associated with climate change, in which we do think that it is related to climate change. First, on extreme heat waves, flash floods and runoffs, desertification and dust storms impacts. Finally, I will conclude and provide some remarks. So looking at the Gulf is around 1,000 kilometers along its main axis. It is quite shallow, but it is deeper towards the eastern coast rather than the western coast. The western coast is quite shallow. The average depth is approximately 35 meters. The tides are semi-diurnal. High tides towards, due to the hydrographic settings, of course, is high towards the north, and lower tidal ranges are in the south. It is categorized as a weak estuary, and what is meant by weak estuary is that the freshwater inflows is quite limited. It is mainly concentrated at the head of the Gulf, which is Shatt al-Arab, very close to Kuwait waters. Therefore, the Gulf is quite saline water. It could be categorized as hypersaline water. The weather is quite harsh and warm, and therefore high evaporation rates and minimal flash water influx lead to a very dense water. The region is dominated by seasonal wind regime, mostly Shamal winds coming blowing from northwest, and the summer water is quite warm. Now, most of the results that I'm gonna show and present are mainly driven by models. But those models has been we've been working with for a while, and they are set on hydrodynamics, coupled on offline basis on water quality, sediment transport, particle tracking. We do have also 2D, 3D models, different setup and assumptions, including hydrostatic and non-hydrostatic, as well as regular curvilinear flexible mesh. And they are available for normal and parallel computing. I don't wanna present those detailed model settings. Probably it won't be interesting to many, but rather the results of those models. But before I present those model results and dive deeper into the presentation, is like, I would like to mention that those models has been heavily validated with some sort, with many data collected from the field, mainly concentrated up north in Kuwait's water, which give the validity of the model, since our boundaries start from the Strait of Hormuz, which is the neck of the Gulf itself. So we use autonomous sensors, we use aerial unmanned vehicles equipped with thermal sensors as well. We do have a real-time monitoring system and so on and so forth. So we keep track on our validations. We do validate for 2D and 3D models. So we have built up our confidence when we present our results and show them and address some conclusions. Now, looking at the seasonal models of the Gulf. The Gulf has a strong temperature signature. So in summer, it is quite warm, and in winter is quite cold. And there is transition between that during autumn and spring. But looking at the salinity, it doesn't vary too much, but rather it is affected by the Indian Ocean through the Strait of Hormuz at the eastern coast of the Gulf, where you see the intrusions of the Indian Ocean and how this is affecting the salinity levels. Yet, it will impose some sort of horizontal density gradients. And this, of course, do affect the how how the water circulates. But looking at the western coast of the Gulf, it is quite saline, and the salinity could exceed 60 ppt in some cases. Now, due to this setting, the Gulf has an approximately 3 to 5 years of residence time. Therefore, the slow turnover rate affects the dispersal of pollutants and contaminants, making it particularly vulnerable to environmental stress. Now, focusing on Kuwait's water is hypersaline again, high temperatures during summer. The Kuwait Bay, which is right on the top corner here, is quite warm and saline. And what is a key feature here is the Shatt Al Arab, which involves again a lower salinity water, quite weak. But then this would result in two dynamic systems, estuarine fields and reverse estuarine fields. This is quite key to the region and quite rare to see when you have within a very short distance. Those circulations are affected by larger circulation in the counterclockwise in the Northern Gulf region. This Northern Gulf region anticlockwise circulation has also a seasonal signature. So in summer, it's quite strong, and in winter, it's quite weak. While in the Southern Kuwait coast, it is dominated by a long shore currents. And the shore and the south, and some recent finding indicates that those circulation has been affected due to short and long-term factors, which we will discuss later on. Now, looking at climate change and impacts, it's quite complex to address, but it's all rising from the fact that global temperature is rising. Some parts of the world, there is ice melting. Some other parts, there is extreme weather events. And therefore, the climate change impact, global warming effects on each region is unequal. And there where the complicity lays. And climate change impacts is really caused by a single factor. They are often the results of complex interaction between climate change itself and other existing stresses like pollution. And it's difficult to distinguish. Long-term timescales, of course, are mainly associated with climate change impact, such as sea level rise, shifts in ecosystem. They occur in extended time periods. This makes it very difficult to establish direct causal link between current emission and observed changes. There's a lot of uncertainties and projections. While climate models are constantly improving, there's still uncertainty associated with future climate projections. Now, one of the key in our region in the Gulf is data availability and quality. Historical data and climate environmental variables are not always readily available. And to address these issues relevant to climate change, it requires long period of data, as well as they have to be in good quality, where post-processing, assessing those data is achievable. And therefore, at this stage, I would like to draw your attention that in Kuwait, we have recently deployed a sea level rise station under the GLOSS network, which is hosted by UNESCO and maintained by a data center called BLIS. This station is within Kuwait Bay. It is equipped with two sensors, as you see, radar and submerged sensor, pressure sensor. They are measuring on real time. So if you go to this website now, you would see this data. They are recording and they are available for the scientific community to make their studies on the sea level rise issues. And unfortunately, this is the only station that has been deployed for this purpose, measuring for sea level rise station as and then part of the global network for that purpose. Now in Kuwait, major waterfront developments could be categorized into ports, desalination, power plants, because mainly they are associated together. Recreational zones, hotels, marinas, beach houses, so on and so forth, as well as we do have a one major causeway, as you see, crossing Kuwait Bay from south to north. One of the key projects in Kuwait, this is in the south, is the Al-Khiran Pearl City project, in which land has been excavated for extensive area around 6,500 hectares. The key development include around 11,000 residential plots with 3,000 plots featuring direct access. Those would have issues related to water exchange and water quality, residence time as well, and definitely would have some sort of water deterioration associated with climate change. Now, looking at the main source of fresh water in Kuwait, desalination plants are deployed in from south to north. And in Kuwait, the net production of potable water was approximately 756 million cubic meter. Desalination plants are primary source of fresh water, providing around 92% of water for domestic and industrial needs. In the same year, Kuwait generated around 71 terawatt hours of electricity. And mainly those waters are associated with cooling water. So the rejected water from the plants do have a higher salinity and higher temperature than the intakes. And those plumes do extend for several hundred meters, having several impacts on the receiving water. Now for the causeway, the combined length of the causeway, of Jabal Rahmat causeway, from south to north, and also the extension in Doha Bay, which is the small part here, is approximately 48.5 kilometers, making it one of the longest sea bridges globally. Two artificial islands, each spanning for 30 hectares, providing facilities for maintenance and emergency services. The main links here is the key. The main links includes about 1,200 piers. And what it does is that issues with sediment transports within the main channel of the bay. A lot of sediments are in action. And of course, this mega infrastructure have influences on the environment. Now, looking at the density, vessel density within the Gulf region and at the north specifically, significant vessel density is concentrated in major ports in Kuwait, Iraq, and Iran, indicating heavy marine traffic related to trades of oil and transportation. And of course, there's high density shipping lanes leading to the Northern Gulf through the Strait of Hormuz, and high density in specific areas could lead to environmental stresses. One of them is oyster fish kill associated with invasive species was in the ballast water. Now, this most has led to major algal blooms, fish kill events, and many occasions. However, it is very difficult to associate those projects with man-made short-term effects or long-term effects like climate change. But we do have some indications. Looking at the frequency where algal blooms events in marine Kuwait marine water from 1987 until 2017, we see a huge rise in those events, doubling as we progress in time. And those, of course, mainly related to man-made and combined effect, man-made and climate change. Now, we looked at the three key issues that we have data, and we try to link those data to climate change. We will look at extreme heat waves, precipitation or rain, and dust storm events. As I mentioned, we deployed a real-time monitoring system in Kuwait Bay, For the past almost 10 years, we record temperatures, we calibrate our sensors, we ensure that our sensors are working as a way where it should be working, and ensure they are functioning properly. And in 2020, we recorded one of the extreme sea surface water temperature that has reached 37.6 degrees, which is magnificent. This extreme temperature coincided with prolonged heat wave, low wind speed, high humidity, neap tides conditions. Magnificent ecological impacts, including fish kill events, not even small species, but also large species. So looking at the impact of these heat waves, and according to the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which recommends about 0.26 degrees Celsius per decade of a total increase on 2100 would reach 2.6 degrees. So we use our model that I've shown previously to validate against the data that I've shown in the previous slide. And this shows that after validating and then increasing the temperature as per the IPCC, an increase of 2 to 4% on sea surface currents that I've shown in the counterclockwise dominant current and the alongshore currents in the south. What does this mean? This means that this would lead to a shift in transport regime, suspended material, nutrients, and trace metals, particularly coming from Shatt al-Arab or elsewhere from east to west. And therefore, it will have significant impact on the local biodiversity. High temperatures, heat waves, doesn't only lead to this, but also often leads to high demand of water. And in the GCC have one of the highest, if not the highest, consumption of water, reaching to 410 liters per capita per day. This as per the World Bank water data reports. This means putting a lot of pressure on the desalination and power plants. So the power is used for air conditioning purposes and desalination for water use, domestic water use. And this increases the energy consumption. So warmer water can reduce the efficiency of cooling system within the plant. We have many cutoffs over the past years of the plant. One of the reasons is the reduced efficiency. And it also reduces the membrane efficiency in the RO systems. High temperatures can lead to reduced membrane lifespan and efficiency. Higher scaling and fouling risks, warm water can promote scaling and biofouling. So we looked at the solutions, and the solution within the desalination plan would be cooling systems, anti-fouling treatment, and membrane adaptation. However, to what we think that could be studied by us is that the increase of intake length and depth, where you can have more fresher water coming into the desalination and power plant, and you have relatively cooler water to improve the efficiency. So restructuring the desalination plant intakes and building scenarios on this, we use the Kuwait Bay model, which has been previously validated and trusted, and build several scenarios by extending the intake of Doha desalination plant for 100 meter each scenario until we reach a cooler water, which we think that would improve the efficiency. However, increasing on an increment of 100 meter will increase the cost significantly. So as you see, the water, the intake as it increases, the price exponentially increases for deploying such intakes. Each 1 degree increase in intake water temperature leads to higher operational cost and reduced plant efficiency. So optimal intake design, balancing intake depth and temperature, is crucial to minimize cost and maximize this desalination efficiency. And therefore, strategic planning, informed decision on intake parameters are essential for the plant's economic and operational success, which indicate that the future of desalination plants, probably in Kuwait and elsewhere within the Gulf, is at stress already. Now, heat waves also promote physical events through hypoxia. So the hypoxia is where dissolved oxygen reaches to zero, where fish cannot stand and die. And this happened in Kuwait. Extreme temperature during the 2020 event, the dissolved oxygen demand was very high due to biological breakdown as well. And we looked into the processes, including respiration and nutrient fluxes from seabed, since it is shallow water. And in shallow water, the sediment water interactions are high. So we revisited a hypoxic condition in 2020. On the left panel, you see this is the event, which has been validated previously with real data using our model that I mentioned previously. And then we look at the climate change conditions in summer for the 2100 projection as per the IPCC. So simply we revisited the settings, the same settings, and then we just increased the temperature. And then we look at the hypoxic parcels which kill the fish. And we realize that the increase in hypoxic area was from 9.7 kilometers squared to 13.2 kilometers squared, which means that 36% of area has increased in the hypoxic parcels. Should this happen again in 2100? What does this mean also? This means there might be the scale of fish, depending on the fish grounds and nursery grounds, might be significant. We look now on the second area, which is the annual rain levels. We are fortunate to have those readings, which extends from 1962 until 2022, probably up to date. And we see that there is some extreme events during the past few years. Although it is low, probably if we compare those levels to elsewhere around the world, but it is high for dry area like Kuwait. Of course, this affects the Shatalara discharges. The data that I've shown here was related to Kuwait, but because it is close again to Shatalara in Iraq. And we got two extreme levels. When there is no rainy season, the estuarine fields is quite confined and minimal, while the salinity levels are quite high in this area. When extreme events happen, this covers large portion of Kuwait's water, including Kuwait Bay. And you can see on the right-hand panel, this is chlorophyll generated from remotely sensed data. You see that there is a significant variations between same seasons in different years. So the models can predict the extent of the estuarine fields when fresh water is discharged from Shatalara. The issue here is that there is an extreme shifts in salinity between a very high salinity and very low salinity. Very low salinity, which impacts the biodiversity, with some species has been affected in the short term. When there is no salinity, we realized that in some research that my colleagues have conducted, that there has been some species disappearing. So this shift of nutrient input composition and affecting the microalgal assemblages which play a crucial role in the overall ecological productivity. This also alters the balance between different primary producers. Also, it extends the estuarine circulation. It alters the sediment dynamics and the horizontal transport processes within the estuarine fields. These events can lead to increased erosion, sedimentary suspension, and redistribution. And of course, this extends to waterfront development, like the desalination plants and so on. The influx of sediment and the associated changes in turbidity can impact light availability for primary productivity and the suitability of habitats for various organisms. And of course, it can shift bed sediments. Now, we looked into those two extremes and what it has led to over the past years. Those two extremes of freshwater influxes has resulted in an unbalanced bloom records. So for example, if we are used to blue algal bloom in April of an X species, nowadays those algal blooms seems to be variable and occurring at different periods of the season, which indicate a disruption to the ecosystem. Some species do bloom on a certain period. Nowadays, they bloom in a different period. And obviously, there is a drop, a huge drop in the fish stock of Kuwait market. If you see over the past year, this drop, of course, amongst many reasons associated with human behavior, there seems to be a relation with the algal blooms and the effects of climate. Last but not least, the impact of dust storms. The Gulf, the Northern Gulf especially, is situated around the arid regions with substantial loose sediment vulnerable to erosion. Dust storms in the region often driven by strong northwesterly shamal winds. They transport significant quantities of fine sediment into the Gulf. The impact of aeolian sediments, which is driven by air here, and sedimentation extends to the marine ecosystem. So it's even during normal conditions, those deposits are available into the system at the northern region. The dust can carry contaminants and potentially toxic elements, posing risk to marine organisms and other habitats. Now, due to the shift in rain patterns and the extended desertification over the past years, new dust sources are emerging in the northern region, and therefore more input of sediment into the area. Now, looking at modeling, from modeling point of view, one of the key is to estimate how much is being dumped into the system. And referring to FODA et al. At 1985, a reasonable assumption is that the 0.8 millimeter per year sedimentation rate of the first 200 kilometers occurred over the entire width of the Northern Gulf. This assumption results about 32 million cubic meter annual deposition of aeolian sediment with a typical density of 1,600 kilogram per meter cube. This would result in about 51 million ton per year into the system. This is magnificent record and several order of magnitude than the average rate of dust deposition in the world's estuaries. Now compare this to the fluvial supply, mainly from Shatt al-Arab, it is 1 to several million tons per year. So the aeolian deposits are dominating. And then we try to validate the model. I don't want to dig deep into the validation of the model, but then once the model is validated, many scenarios could be conducted. The model here is validated with the remotely sensed data, as you see in the left panels. So there's a model column and then the remotely sensed data of turbidity, and we try to relate and see how the model is functioning. Of course, it is also validated with time series, single station, three stations at a single point measuring suspended sediment concentrations. Now, what does this mean? This means we can do various scenarios and assess the impact of climate change and man-human behavior and the desertification that is happening in the north. And as we see here, a record from 1980 until 2020, climate change, rising temperature, alteration in precipitation patterns introduce new dry zones. And you see there is a hint here between 2014 and 2020 that the dust storms are increasing. We try to impose this to our models and to see how those models are behaving with the vicinity of those impacts. So using our validated models, we try to increase the sediment supply from Aeolian desert dust as per the records that I've shown in the previous slide. And we realized that in 2000, and again using the same model for the temperature, and we realized that there is a 17% increase in 2100 in the Northern Gulf. Increased sediment loading would lead to redistribution of sediment in the vicinity of mega infrastructure like the causeway within the Kuwait Bay. And increased sediment would lead to less light penetration, therefore disturbance in the ecological productivity. Higher cost is anticipated to maintain depth of intakes, intake channels like the desalination plant that we have mentioned. And of course, turbidity will increase, waterfront developments is at risk of a huge economical loss in the future. Now to conclude, long-term monitoring programs are essential, and networks are crucial for accurately assessing the understanding and ongoing accumulative effects of climate change, enabling informed decision-making and adaptive strategies. Biodiversity recovery near estuaries is a prolonged process, as a significant salinity fluctuation disrupt the ecological stability, making it difficult for species to adapt and ecosystems to re-establish balance. Numerical models are effective in understanding the implications of extreme events and could aid strategic planning for waterfront developments in Kuwait and probably elsewhere within the Gulf. Hard engineering solutions could be costly and inefficient. This highlights the importance of adopting sustainable, nature-based approaches that are adaptable and cost-effective in the long run. Designing suitable waterfront infrastructure that effectively address the complex challenges of climate change requires adaptive and innovative approaches grounded in science. There are many people who helped me to tell the truth around my career, and they are all over the world, and I'm very grateful for them. But there are two figures here, Professor Roger Faulkner and Jorgen Berger, have made significant changes into my career and helped me a lot throughout the years and many people around the world. So I'd like to take this opportunity to thank them for their contribution in my career, particularly Professor Roger Faulkner, who first introduced me to Kuwait Institute for Scientific Research and where I am now as a full-time research scientist. Thanks for both of them, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Alosairi. It's a very nice presentation, and also I hope this will be a good sharing with our, particularly to our participants from all over the world. So in this engagement webinar, Dr. Alosairi has explored the critical intersection of climate change and coastal development in Kuwait. So he has also addressed the key challenges posed by rising sea levels, extreme weather events, and ecosystem degradations, as well as emphasizing on their impact on both infrastructures and also the local communities, especially in Kuwait. So he also highlighted a few remarks, for example, long-term monitoring programs, biodiversity recovery, numerical modelings, hard engineering, as well as the designing sustainable waterfront infrastructures. So I think this is a very good sharing that you have been presented just now. We thank you very much for your kind sharing. And we have a few questions here from some other colleagues from all over the world here. So maybe let me, since we have still have about 15 minutes to go before 10 a.m. in UK. So let me read out a few questions here so that you can answer. At the same time, Dr. Yousef, maybe you can also refer back to the Q&A sections, the chat box, so that you can also look into the questions. So maybe let me read out one of the questions here. What is the predicted impacts of increasing the desalination production by double in the 2037 on Arabian Gulf water qualities? So are you able to answer these questions here?
So what is the predicted impacts on the increase in desalination productivity by doubling in 2037 on the Gulf water quality? Well, it will, on the Gulf scale, it will have, of course, a localized impact. But I would believe that, again, the impact will be mostly on the physical parameters. And this is associated with the thermal plumes and the high salinity plumes. This would result probably in a dense water. But what this would also impose is an exchange through the Strait of Hormuz. I think there would be a significant density-driven currents in this region where fresh water influxes from the surface as the Indian Ocean approached the Gulf. And then this would be exchanged by, replaced, sorry, by, this would replace the saline water leaving the Gulf zone. So there would be high fluxes from the Indian Ocean and more water would probably leave the Gulf near the bottom.
Thank you very much for the answer. Maybe we have the other question from Dongfang, which is one of our colleagues last time. So does the global warming cause a uniform increase of the sea surface temperature? What is the mechanisms that lead to the increased surface currents? Maybe I think it's referring to Kuwait, so maybe in Gulf.
Yeah, it's the Northern Gulf. The increase in surface temperature, also the shamal wind during summer is quite dry, and because of the pitch and the heat that it is imposed on the surface water, it creates a counterclockwise circulation to move relatively faster, and this thin layer of surface currents are affected by this heat absorption. That's why you would see that the counterclockwise circulation is increased because it is overlaid by the cooler, relatively cooler water near the bottom. So that's why we saw this. This is what we believe, in fact, and unless we are missing something in our model, this is what we believe that is driving the counterclockwise circulation, faster movement, and some. There, we also realize there's some chaotic circulations near the coast as well, but this requires further verification.
Okay. Thank you very much. So maybe I read the other questions here. Is there any inter-collaboration for monitoring the water quality for the Gulf, especially for the coastal area in the Kuwait?
Well, this is on an institutional level. Probably there is a collaboration here and there, but not the one that I'm aware of at the moment. Probably the EPA, you know, environmental agencies around the Gulf, probably they are collaborating and cooperating, maybe in ROPME, the regional organization for the the preservation of the water and seawater. Maybe there are some sort of exchange of data, etc. But what I'm aiming here is that those data should be readily available for scientific purposes and scientific research, and they should be also maintained in good quality, so that when you do analysis and very detailed analysis relevant to climate change, you can get very reliable conclusions that help in taking action and decision making in the region.
Yeah, definitely. I think you need the collaboration within countries as well as within the internationals. And
yeah.
There is one more question they are interested on: any adaptation fund set up by the Kuwait governments. So this will be either for the coastal resilience or otherwise, maybe.
Well, there, I'm not sure if there is an adaptation funds, but in here in Kuwait, all the ministries, they are responsible of maintaining their infrastructure. And also this applies for the commercial sector, I believe. So the owner of the facility, they do their own adaptation accordingly. What we do normally in Kuwait Institute for Scientific Research, if we have a key finding and we realize that this information could help Ministry X or stakeholder X, we would communicate and try to supply this information, and probably they would need to find out ways to resolve it. If they ask for our help and support, we will try to do so and try to give some solutions, but sometimes it's not easy to convince stakeholders.
Yeah, okay. So we have listened to your presentation just now. You have mentioned the Kuwait have experienced and also faced the impact from the climate change. How about the sensitive area around Kuwait? For example, a few places that mentioned by our colleagues here, the islands, Bobian islands. So is there any solutions or any maybe impacts that have been faced here?
Yeah, Bubian Island, the water is quite turbid, and it seems that the turbidity, suspended sediment particles are increasing over the years. And what does this mean, as I mentioned earlier, is that it will lead to a low productivity area. Low productivity meaning that the biodiversity is quite low due to the limited light penetration. I think there's a nutrient available, and dissolved oxygen is on a reasonable level for productivity. But then the suspended sediments are quite high due to the dust input and arid areas. Probably this would help, and even if this solution seems to be expensive, is to plant areas of dust sources up north in Iraq, for example, and Syria, where the loose sediment is get trapped by vegetation, and this will help, of course, to get the sediments trapped within those planted zones. And then after that, we would see that the sediment arriving from the air into landing the water is reduced. And once this is reduced, then we would expect a higher productivity and better water quality in those regions, rather than having the high salinity and the high suspended sediments. Of course, again, there is some issues from Sheikh Al-Arab discharges. I think the countries should get together and try to find out solutions where the dam construction should be in a way where it allow more water into the system, and of course use the events of flash floods, trying to to reuse it and recycle those waters, probably redirected into the river, and therefore this will improve the northern the northern Gulf water quality by all means.
Yeah, thank you for your answer. There's one more question I think that should be important for us to further discuss here. You have mentioned about the algae blooms that happened in Kuwait coastal line, and also what are the key parameters that actually contributing to this type of eutrophications around the area, especially the study that you have carried out, and also what is the threshold value being established for these parameters?
What is driving the algal blooms? Probably it's a combined effect, to tell the truth. It is difficult to trigger one or two factors, but definitely the nutrient input. The nutrient input is through the outfalls is quite high. Not nowadays. Nowadays they are okay, but then the area is quite shallow. So when the nutrient is being discharged from those outfalls, they contaminate the sediments. And some areas within Kuwait Bay are very fine. They are cohesive sediments and they absorb a lot of nutrients. They are fully saturated nowadays. So the improvement of water quality, even if the household stop discharging nutrients, it will remain there for a while until it's cleared out by the currents, by the dynamics of the system. So nowadays we see a decline in algal blooms, to tell the truth. And in 2024, the records are quite low compared to 2003, 2002. I'm not sure why, you know, to pinpoint the actual reason is quite difficult and complex when it comes to water quality without having detailed data. But I think there is a slight recovery for the environment, and this is associated with the sediments being less contaminated because of the outfalls has stopped discharging those nutrients.
I see. Okay, that's great. We have one more question from Professor Yang from University of Wollongong. So could you please comment on the brain impacts on the ecosystem after desalination in your regions?
Well, to tell the truth, I am an engineer and I don't know much about the ecosystem. But what I know is that you know, it's easier for me to see a, you know, an issue from an engineer point of view, is that when you see a fish killed, fish dead, then you realize that there's something wrong. But digging deep into the ecosystem is quite large to discuss or address from an engineer point of view, if you like. But desalination plants do put a lot of stress, particularly on respiration of those different algal groups. This is what I understand from my colleagues when they're trying to educate me in these areas. Of course, also the desalination plants allow more nutrients to flux from the sediment bed. Normally, the discharge of the desalination plants are in shallow zones, so they affect the bed a lot, seabed, I mean. So they allow more fluxes from the sediment into the overlaying water. And therefore, you know, this will act as a source of nutrients and, of course, different implications on the ecological hierarchy until it reaches to the fish.
Okay. I think we cannot answer all the questions here. We still have more questions coming in. I'm so sorry about that. And we are coming to the 10 a.m. in UK. And before I close the session, I would just like to thank everyone, especially thanks our speakers here, Dr. Yousef Alosairi, as well as to thanks our secretariats from IWA, who are very kind to help us to make our webinar here smoothly. And also on behalf of the specialist groups, We hope that we can have more webinar in the futures, and we would like to share more. But before we close, I think maybe Professor Sivakumar, you want to say the last word before I close it.
Thank you, Prof. Sitio. I think I immensely enjoyed the seminar of Dr. Alosairi. You are really doing an excellent job there. Particularly, you know, we have numerical models, but you have really shown how you have gone and verified them through various types of real time as well as autonomous. That's a very important aspect of the work. I think there are a number of questions in terms of environmental impact has come through. Maybe we should try to answer some of those things, if at all possible, outside, because that is something I can see the thread there. There are the environmental impact on brines, environmental impact on in the ecosystem, what's happening. We'll try and see whether we can answer some of them as much as we can. So that's all I have. Please go ahead, Professor Gio, in the rest.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Sivakumar. So I hope all of you can join us during our upcoming IWA webinar and also events. So the screen will be shared with you some of the webinar in line for you in the, until the end of the years. So look forward to meeting you, and also hopefully to have more discussion and more engagement with you on the topics, especially on our specialty group, which is on the sustainable estuary and also coastal developments. Thank you, and see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.